Kia ora koutou, I'm Ursula Cochran. I'm an earthquake geologist and I work at GNS Science. Today I'm going to be talking about the Alpine Fault. And in particular, two questions about the Alpine Fault from an earthquake geologist's perspective. So firstly, how do we know large earthquakes happen on this fault? And secondly, how do we know the likelihood of a large earthquake happening soon? Right here on the slide, you can see the first clue. This long, straight line that runs up the South Island of New Zealand is the Alpine Fault, and that is actually a break in the Earth's crust. We've seen quite a few breaks in the Earth's crust recently, with the Kaikoura earthquake of 2016. 20 or more faults ruptured to the ground surface in that earthquake. And here you can see at top right a break on the Leader Fault, and down the bottom a break on the Papatea Fault, where the crust has been ripped apart in an earthquake. This is exactly what's been happening on the Alpine Fault for thousands and thousands of years. And you can imagine easily that if these earthquakes keep happening on the same fault, you end up with a long straight line in the crust that we see here today. The other thing we can see, again, from the Kaikoura earthquake on the top of the screen here, this is the Kekeringu Fault that has ripped across this paddock. But also, it has offset horizontally something that used to be joined across the fault. So in pink rectangles there, that is a trench that was dug across the fault to study it. And in the earthquake, the two sides of the trench were moved horizontally by 9 metres. So we saw this in real time today in New Zealand. But we can also look back in time. In the bottom picture, you see the Alpine Fault is a straight line running through this topographic map. And we can follow little stream channels as they try to cross the fault, but they're actually offset horizontally. This is how we can measure how far the fault has moved in single earthquakes in the past. And it's not just horizontal movement, it's also vertical movement. So often earthquake geologists are digging big trenches across fault lines to look at the offset in sediments. In the top left on the Ohariu Fault, you can see a brown sedimentary layer that would have once been horizontal, and it's now been offset to the top of the picture on the right-hand side. Again, from Kaikoura, we had amazing examples of the seafloor being lifted vertically above sea level and a whole lot of seaweed and marine creatures dying off. So on the Alpine Fault, in the bottom picture here, we have been digging trenches across that fault to look at these sediments that have been offset by movements in single earthquakes. And this is how we get the evidence for those very large earthquakes happening on the Alpine Fault. When you piece these sites together along the fault, you can then start to say this was a really large earthquake that ruptured all these sites in one go. And of course, the reason for this rupturing of the crust, or the breaking of the crust, is plate tectonics. New Zealand is pretty much obscured in this picture because it's right under a plate boundary between the Pacific plate and the Australian plate. And we know that new oceanic crust is being formed at the mid-ocean ridges, and that crust is spreading out, and somewhere it has to go. Somewhere has to give and break. So the Alpine Fault in the South Island of New Zealand is doing its bit to accommodate that movement between the Pacific Plate and the Australian Plate, with up to 14 millimetres in the north, 30 millimetres in the south per year. But of course, this is not movement happening continuously through time. This is movement that's happening in large earthquakes. So is a large earthquake on the Alpine Fault a bit like Lotto, where the chances of winning the jackpot are a very remote possibility that we needn't worry about? Well, no. We've been doing work that shows the chance of the next large earthquake is actually quite high. And I'd like to show you how we know that. So we need a long earthquake record, and in a geologist's perspective, a long earthquake record is one that contains a sample of many past earthquakes over thousands of years so that we can get a very good picture of how these faults behave and how often they have large earthquakes. You can see in this example at the top, if we take a short period of time, say a few hundred years, and we only have a few earthquakes to look at, how are we going to forecast that into the future? We might do it something like this, where we see the past few earthquakes happening quite regularly in time and just assume they're going to continue into the future like that. The lower arrow is a longer period of time, say thousands of years with quite a few more earthquakes. And if we try to forecast that into the future, we might see a different picture from the short earthquake record. So from the perspective of now, these two scenarios are quite different. In the top scenario, we might be expecting a large earthquake really quite soon. In the lower scenario, we might say, look, these earthquakes happen in clusters in time, and we've got a big gap before the next one's going to happen. So we really want to get these long earthquake records to give us more reliable estimates of the frequency of large earthquakes and their recurrence patterns in time. So we've been working at the very southern end of the Alpine Fault, the southwestern section that you can see on the right there, at two very special sites that hold thousands of years worth of records of past Alpine Fault earthquakes. One of these sites is Hakuta Creek, just near Lake Makero at the end of the Holyford Track, and the other is at John O'Groats River, just north of the mouth of Milford Sound. This is what these sites look like, and in each case you can see a straight line running through the middle of the picture that is the Alpine Fault. You can also see streams coming out of the hills here and butting up against the fault. And this is the key to why these sites have been so amazing in giving us their history of earthquakes. It's the impact that that fault line has on the drainage at these sites that has preserved evidence of earthquakes. If we look at a block model, we can see more clearly how this works. So between earthquakes, the stream at Hakuri Creek is flowing across the Alpine Fault. It's found a channel and it can flow out to the lake that way. During an earthquake, we know that this left-hand side of the Alpine Fault moves at least 7.5 metres horizontally and also about a metre vertically. So you can imagine this is immediately going to block that stream and result in flooding of the valley floor. If we look in cross-section at what this flooding does, we can see that before an earthquake, we've just got a wetland soil accumulating. This is on the down-thrown side of the Alpine Fault scarp. So we're going to get a peaty soil in that valley. When the earthquake happens and the fault block moves, blocks the river, you're going to get the whole valley flooded and bringing silt down from the catchment, and so you get a layer of silt deposited above your brown soil. And the amazing thing is that this can keep going with every earthquake because each earthquake creates more space for that sediment to accumulate against the fault. So we basically get a sediment package that cycles through peat to silt, representing an earthquake. We saw this in 2010 in the Darfield earthquake, where the Hororata River at the top of this photo was trying to cross the Greendale Fault scarp. And the upthrown side of the Greendale Fault stopped that river flowing across. And so here on the bottom right of the photo, you can see that what was a farmer's paddock with some beautiful soil accumulating then became covered in silt hours after the earthquake. At Hakuri Creek, in the banks of the stream, we see these outcrops that are basically stripy. They are brown soils overlain by grey silts repeating up through these outcrops again and again. These are the earthquakes. So the top of the brown soil was the ground at the time of the earthquake. The grey silt represents the flood deposits that came down when the stream was blocked by movement on the fault. And we've been able to get the ages of these earthquakes through radiocarbon dating. And at Hakuta Creek, we found evidence over 8,000 years of 22 earthquakes. The problem was we were missing the most recent 1,000 years at Hakuta Creek. So we came to the John O'Groat site, which is really a modern analogue. We don't have outcrops here because this system is still recording earthquakes. We have a wetland on the downthrown side of the fault, and we took cores into that wetland and we found the same kind of stratigraphy or the same layers of sediment with the dark brown soils overlain by light grey silts. And again, we were able to identify these as earthquakes using a whole lot of different methods of looking in detail at the sediments. Some of what we did was looking at microfossils to determine the past environments where these sediments were laid down. Another thing was collecting in detail. You can see all the labelling of the outcrop, tiny little leaves and seeds to get the radiocarbon dates, to get the ages of these earthquakes. We really wanted to make sure that we were looking at an earthquake signal and not a climate change signal or some other kind of history. So this is a timeline with time at the top going back to 6,000 BC or 8,000 years ago. And all we've shown here is a few blobs of time when we knew there were past earthquakes on the Alpine Fault from around Haast. The very top right yellow spot is the present day. What we've added to this picture through this work at Hakuta Creek and John O'Groats is this. So the black curves are the ages of earthquakes from Hakuta Creek. The green curves are the ages of earthquakes from John O'Groats River. I might just do that again because the change is so amazing. This is what we knew before. We knew of 3 or 4 earthquakes on the Alpine Fault at the southern end. We now know of 27 earthquakes over 8,000 years. This is a really good sample of earthquakes. It is pretty rare worldwide to have such a long length of time and so many earthquakes on one fault that we know about. The first thing we can immediately see from this figure is the next earthquake is inevitable. And we're able to figure out the average time between earthquakes from this number of past records. And we can see on the right there, it's about 290 years that these occur. We can also see that these earthquakes occur relatively regularly in time, especially when we compare that internationally. So if we look at the top is the Alpine Fault with our earthquakes in time. The next one is the San Andreas Fault in America, where they have far more frequent earthquakes, reasonably regular, but not as perfect as the Alpine Fault. And then down the bottom from the Dead Sea Rift, we have examples of random earthquakes in time, or maybe slightly clustered in time, and also less frequent than our Alpine Fault. So when we have a series of fairly regularly repeating earthquakes like this, we really want to know, when did that last one happen and what are we up for next? Well, the most recent great earthquake on the Alpine Fault was exactly 300 years ago. And when you compare that to our average interval between earthquakes of 290 years, you can see that we are entering the time where a great earthquake on this fault would not be a surprise. It's true there's a lot of variability in that recurrence, so our longest interval is about 510 years. And we hope we're entering a long interval now, but also our shortest interval, only 140 years. And we call this a great earthquake because it was over magnitude 8. There is enough evidence along the fault to know that 380 kilometres of it broke in this 1717 AD earthquake. The Southern Alps have moved more than 7 metres southwards and a metre upwards at different places along the fault in that earthquake. We see evidence for extensive landsliding with sediment being deposited in the lakes and rivers of the west coast. And we also see extensive damage to trees all along the fault. And this is important because that's where we get the 1717 AD date from tree rings that have been suppressed or damaged during that earthquake. So what's the likelihood of a large earthquake happening soon? Once we take all that variability into account statistically, we can say there's a 29% chance of a large earthquake in the next 50 years. And one of my colleagues likes to represent it like this. You've got a barrel of a gun with 10 chambers, 3 of them are filled with bullets. Is this a chance you want to take to do nothing about? To me, this is a chance that's high enough to consider. It's a much, much greater chance than my likelihood of winning a lotto jackpot. So I don't want to worry about this every day, but I do want to do my bit to be prepared to live comfortably through such an event within the next 50 years. One thing we do need to remember is that these statistics are only for the southwestland section of the Alpine Fault, right down at the bottom. So for the central and northwestland sections of the Alpine Fault, there's a lot of ongoing research, for example, from lakes giving us long earthquake records at various points along the fault and also from trenches across the fault. And these are showing different results from what we've got in southwestland and possibly even higher probabilities of the next earthquake. So this evidence to me is enough to say there will be another Alpine Fault earthquake, and it is worthwhile spending some time thinking about how we can get ready as individuals and communities to be better prepared for the next event. Thank you very much.